Welcome, everybody. It's nice to see so many people here. Thank you for joining us for this 22 launch of the 10 new insights in climate science. My name is Wendy Broadgate. I'm the Global Hub Director of Future Earth based in Stockholm, and I'll be your moderator for the next 30 minutes. Before I introduce our speakers, I'll start with a very short with an overview of the report and our agenda for the session. So the 10 New Insights in Climate Science is a joint initiative of Future Earth, Earth League, and the World Climate Research Programme. The annual report series synthesizes the latest climate science-related research for the international science policy community. Since 2017, the reports have been launched at the Climate COP with the UNFCCC Executive Secretary. And we're very glad to be continuing this tradition with Mr. Simon Steele. This report was prepared by a consortium of 65 leading researchers from 23 countries. It responds to clear calls for policy guidance during this climate critical decade. In a year of compounding crises, including geopolitical instability, extreme weather events, and reverberations from the pandemic, the 10 New Insights in Climate Science delivers essential research findings and distills them into policy recommendations to inform decisions here at COP27. So here on the screen is our agenda for the day. I'll shortly hand over to the Executive Secretary, Mr. Simon Steele, for his welcome address, followed by a top-line presentation of the insights from Professor Rockström. We'll then proceed to short interventions from the other authors present, followed by Q&A with some of the report's global experts, where you can pose your questions to the panel. Colleagues in the room will come to you with the microphones. So our speakers are Mr. Simon Steele, UNFCCC Executive Secretary, and then the report contributors, Professor Johan Rockström, Director of the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research and Co-Chair of the Earth League. Dr. Lisa Schipper is next on the podium, University of Oxford and University of Bonn, and Professor Christy Eby from the University of Washington. And online, we have Dr. Aditi Mukherjee from the International Water Management Institute in New Delhi. So I'd now like to hand over to you, Mr. Steele, UNFCCC Executive Secretary. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Wendy. And still morning, warm good morning to all of you. So colleagues, friends, it is a pleasure to be here. Thank you to Future Earth, the Earth League, and the World Climate Research Programme for producing this year's edition of the 10 New Insights in Climate Science. I want to specifically thank Professor Rockström and his team for their scientific work on global sustainability issues. Professor, we greatly value your expertise, your work, leadership with respect to producing these valuable, really valuable insights. We've received these insights at several COPs now, and I know all delegates eagerly anticipate the findings. Friends, science is at the heart of everything that we do. Amongst the thousands of people here, all from different parts of the world, science is our common language. It's a foundational element that informs this process and one that needs to be counted on. Science provides the evidence and data on the impacts of climate change, but it also gives us the tools and knowledge as to how we need to address it. The insights provided by this report are alarming, confirming some of what we already know, and give us insights into other areas where urgent action is needed. Professor Rockström will provide much more insight into the specifics of this report, but in the interest of time, I want to pick up on one insight from the 10 as it confirms what I've been discussing in recent weeks, that adaptation alone cannot keep up with the impacts of climate change, which are already far worse than originally predicted. Don't get me wrong, adaptation actions are still crucial and are critical to upgrade small-scale, fragmented, and reactive efforts. But as your report says, the potential to adapt to climate change is not limitless, and they will not prevent all losses and damage that we have seen. I therefore applaud parties for getting loss and damage onto the agenda here at COP27, and I certainly look forward to a thorough discussion on this issue, and this is an issue whose time has now come. However, this does not let countries off the hook regarding their emissions. As your first insight says, adaptation actions cannot substitute for ambitious mitigation. Adaptation and mitigation action exists in an inverse relationship. The less we mitigate, the more we have to adapt. So investing in mitigation is a way of reducing the need to invest in adaptation and resilience. That means tabling stronger national climate action plans and doing so now. While parties are starting to lessen the emissions gap, it's a drop in the bucket as to what is actually needed. The Egyptian presidency has made very clear we're now firmly in this era of implementation, and that means action. But none of this can happen without data, without evidence to inform decisions and decision making, or the science that supports programs and policies. Professor Rockström, you have the UNFCCC's full support for this report, and I will personally share these insights with parties and non-party groups here at this COP. It provides crucial support for their work, our work, together here at COP27 and beyond. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Steele. Thank you for your support. I turn the microphone to Johan Rockström.
Yeah, thank you. And well, to begin with, Simon Steele, colleagues, friends, let me just express, and I dare say on behalf of the entire scientific community, how much we appreciate your leadership, Simon, of the UNFCCC. Science is the common language for the policy interface. The fact that we produced the 10 NICs is actually a reaction of the scientific frustration that we need to connect even deeper with policy, and we're so appreciative that we have this handover, this ceremonial handover here, and that you can then help us to reach with these insights right across all the negotiating teams in this crucial time for climate action. So if we take the first slide, please. Insight number one, just like Simon Steele points out, is building actually on the 2021 10 NICs, where we concluded that 1.5 is not a goal, it's a physical limit. Go beyond it and we are likely to trigger tipping points. But now we have more and more scientific evidence that it also poses limits to adaptation. This is really serious. Go beyond 1.5 and we risk going beyond what particularly vulnerable communities can cope with, reach 2 degrees, and we are at a point where it's worth repeating that adaptation can under no circumstance substitute mitigation. Next, please. We have this based on the science which shows that both the frequency on the y-axis and the intensity of climate extremes are on the increase. IPCC concludes this very clearly, and this is what poses...
Well, 1, 2, 3, super.
Approaching hard limits. Next, please.
English.
Adaptation limitations, that we have vulnerability hotspots which cluster around regions at risk. And we're today able to identify these hotspot regions of social economic risks across the world. And that 1.6 billion people already today live in vulnerability hotspots, a number that will double in 2050 if we continue burning fossil fuels as today. Dear friends, that's 1/3 of the world's population living in regions that are approaching limitations of adaptation and being at risk of social instability. Next. We have this mapped out. We have the regions. We even have an analytical framework to look at the strength and the time scales to cope with this pressure caused by both direct and indirect greenhouse gas implications, everything from ecological collapse to warming and heat stress. Next, please. Insight number three. We have evidence of new threats on the horizon from climate health interactions. This is a rapidly emerging field of research where health scientists and climate change scientists are putting forward the evidence that the impacts of climate change on health for both humans, animals, and ecosystems are today widespread and emerging and rising rapidly. Next. We have this mapped out across the different selected risks. And remember that this is not only extreme heat and wildfires and floods, it's also the risk of rising infectious diseases. We have Chris Ebbe here as a professor in climate health, and she will definitely, I'm sure, deepen this. The key insight here is that we need urgent policy advancements, surveillance, early warning systems, and really multi-sectoral information sharing and action to make the climate agenda a true human health protection agenda. We also need, just like Samuel Steve pointed out, that the mitigation adaptation investments are done in an integrated fashion for human health. Next, please. Insight number four. Climate mobility, a really rapidly advancing area of scientific evidence on the ground, which is showing increasingly that climate change is causing a threat amplifying for displacement, migration, potentially pushing societies towards conflict. If you take the next slide here, we have now quantifications on the weather-related and the dark green here, how they dominate the risks of mobility, of displacement of people, everything from the floods, storms, wildfires, droughts, landslides, extreme temperatures. While, of course, we also have conflicts, which is together causing the rising pressures on human displacement. We show increasingly that climate change, while not being a direct cause of conflict, is an amplifier of risk of social instabilities and unwanted climate mobility. Next, please. Insight five, human security requires climate security. If you take all these four insights together, that we are at risk of reaching limits of adaptation, we have climate health impacts, we have larger risk of climate mobility, we also have rising evidence that if we want to have a secure and peaceful future, we need to address climate change very rapidly, and that this is something which is now being at the forefront, even conflicts being triggered and amplified by the risks of climate change. Next, please. Insight number six. Sustainable land use is essential to meet climate targets. This was a very central topic in Glasgow at COP26. It is centrally now mainstreamed within the whole climate negotiations. The scientific evidence is crystal clear. The IPCC shows that 25% of emissions of greenhouse gases are absorbed by intact nature. We have the Global Carbon Project will be releasing its budget tomorrow. Pierre Freligstein and team are in the room here, who will be providing the latest numbers on the amazingly important role played by land as a mitigation strategy for our ability to land within the Paris range. So this is something that we need to work much, much harder with to connect the land and the climate policy agendas together in the future. Next, please. Insight seven, private sustainable finance practices are failing to catalyze deep transitions. This is a really significant part of research where we are today, unfortunately, finding that all the good work on sustainable finance are still operating within the current existing business models, which are not substantially shifting the allocation of capital towards meaningful mitigation, meaning that we're still doing a lot of good work on finance, but it's only scratching on the surface and not really having the deep indent on shifting the financial flows at the pace and scale required. Next, please. And we have the numbers here, as you all know, on the, for example, all the sustainable finance that is now being brought forward. It's equivalent to several trillion US dollars per year of a world economy of 100 trillion US dollars, which just shows that we are far from mainstreaming zero carbon finance, which is what we urgently need to have any chance of a fossil fuel-free world economy by 2050. Next, please. Inside eight, one of the big agendas for COP27 on loss and damage, the scientific community concludes that this is an urgent planetary imperative. We need coordinated global policy response on loss and damage. You take the next slide, please. It is, though, a complex and challenging agenda. Current impacts are causing unavoidable loss and damage, where we need measures for finance, shown in the lower part here, on insurance, social protection, humanitarian actions, reparation investments, but that we also need equal amount of investments to avoid future impacts causing increasing loss and damages that we may not even be able to cope with. So we have to fully, as Simon Steele pointed out in the beginning, we come back to this, integrate adaptation, mitigation with loss and damage. Next. Insight nine, inclusive decision making for climate resilient development is an imperative and needed. This is, a lot of the social sciences are now, not surprisingly, showing how we need to get local scales, local needs, local communities, multi-stakeholders engaged to have any chance of robust climate policy implementation. Next, please. Final, 10th climate insight, which is the most complex one and the biggest one. We have increasing scientific evidence that, well, we have unequivocal scientific evidence that systems changes are required to be able to decarbonize the world economy at this pace required. But we are not seeing those system changes out there in the real world. We need to break down many of the structural barriers that are upstream causing our inability to really move away from incremental change to transformative change. And if you take the next final slide here, you have a framework for this, where in the green boxes you see the upstream levers of change, which we in the scientific community today identify as being necessary to have as part of the climate policy agenda. And let me just emphasize the upper left one here, which is the multidimensional progress on indicators based on human well-being, meaning shifting away from a GDP-based growth model to have much stronger emphasis on inclusive wealth and human well-being. Just factoring in the right price on carbon is one of the key issues required to represent much better the true human cost of climate damage. So there are many parts here that need to be put in place for us to be able to accelerate. And if you take the next, I think thereby we are ready with the walkthrough. Back to you, Wendy.
Thank you, Johan.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for that. Thank you, Mr. Simon Steele, for joining us. Very much appreciated. Thank you, Johan, for that rapid overview. Before we have Q&A, I'm just going to turn to very short interventions or perspectives from the other authors, both in the room and online. So I'll turn to you first, Dr. Elisa Schipper.
Thank you. Well, building on Johan's quick summary there, I think maybe to emphasize that these 10 insights provide a really nice, very holistic overview, because they're looking at essentially the same problem but from different perspectives, and that allows for the reader to really get an insight into what the complexity is. But I would emphasize particularly that when we're talking about hitting adaptation limits, which is something in the IPCC is emphasized very much, in the context of the growing discussions around loss and damage, I think we also, what the insights show is that adaptation also needs to be improved, that the current way of doing it, that we need to rethink a little bit how we're approaching adaptation, and particularly that we need to consider that vulnerability is a key factor in understanding how to plan adaptation. And this links with the inclusive decision-making for climate-resilient development that's mentioned in the Insight 9. So if we think about vulnerability, it offers us a chance to think more inclusively, and that means bringing in marginalized groups in the decision-making process so that we can actually ensure that we don't end up with higher vulnerability and maladaptation.
Thank you, Lisa. So now I'll turn to Professor Christy Ebi from the University of Washington.
Thank you. Early quantifications are showing us that thousands to tens of thousands of people are dying from climate change right now. And this needs to be taken into the heart of the negotiations. The 10 new insights, of course, are separate 10 insights, but they do integrate. Health integrates across all of these insights. That the upstream drivers of health are reflected across the insights. To be able to effectively increase resilience, to reduce the vulnerability, we have to have human health and well-being at the heart of the negotiations. This COP is about implementation. The major challenge in the health sector is the lack of investment. Under the UNFCCC adaptation funds, less than half of 1% goes to health. We're not going to be able to achieve the goals that we would like to achieve without ensuring we have the investments in adaptation, mitigation, and resilience. Thank you.
Thank you, Christy. And I see we have Mercedes Bustamante online as well. I'll turn first to Aditi Mukherjee. Aditi is from the International Water Management Institute in New Delhi. Over to you, Aditi.
Thank you. My brief overview is that of these 10, I think the first one, the myth of endless adaptation, really goes to the heart of what we are saying in Working Group 2, that beyond a certain degree, much of what we know about adaptation, our effectiveness of adaptation, where also there are large knowledge gaps, by the way. We do not know which adaptation is effective in reducing risk and under what context, but that apart, whatever we know of effectiveness of adaptation at higher levels of global warming, it is pretty certain that those adaptation measures will not remain very effective. And that, I think, it's the highlight, is the number six, which is around sustainable land use in meeting climate targets. And the reason I relate the two is that the people who are at the forefront of the impacts also happen to be the most climate exposed occupations, like farmers. And what we do with our land use also affects those farmers, massively. So I think those two insights are something that really speaks to some of the work that I have been doing, my colleagues at the CGIAR have been doing. And this was, as Professor Ebi says, that these 10 highlights are really one integrated way to say that we need to do action now, and those actions have to be in accordance to the various roles and responsibilities and more participatory. Thank you.
Thank you, Aditi. And finally, Professor Mercedes Bustamante from the University of Brasilia. Over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Wendy. Thank you, Johan, for the presentation. I think one important aspect of the 10 NICs is showing how they how interconnected they are, and thus also provide us multiple entries for action. So we can really address multiple of these factors if we work together. I would like to stress in the standings the vulnerability hotspots, the region at risk, because of the number of people that are already susceptible to the impact of climate change, and how these vulnerability hotspots are bringing together two major challenges for humanity. This is biodiversity conservation and climate change, because most of these vulnerability hotspots are also important regions for biodiversity conservation. And this also added mention, they are also parts of the world that are experiencing extreme land use changes. So I think it's important to consider that, as Johan mentioned, that we have 1.6 billion people that are already affected, and this number must double in the coming years. So it's important now that we are discussing loss and damages that we consider these areas as priority areas for actions. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all. So now I finally turn to questions and answers session. And we have a roaming mic. And please identify yourself when you ask your question. So we have a question in the middle here, please.
Hi, I'm Laurie Gehring from the Thomson Reuters Foundation. It's palpable how much you want to inject the science into policy in the way that you're framing this. And I know you've tried to do that for a long time with limited success, because we're still seeing emissions rising and so on. I'm curious where you see progress toward really doing that here at this carbon in policymaking, and what your lingering, really difficult frustrations are on this.
Thank you for the question. Who would like to answer that? Christy.
Thank you, and I'm happy to start, and I'm sure everyone else has comments as well. It's important to not just look at national policy. It's important to look at what's going on subnationally. It's important to looking at what's going on in terms of what our businesses are doing. There was very little publicity when all of the major automobile manufacturers announced a date when they're out of internal combustion engines. That's a huge shift. It was not driven by government policy. I live in Seattle. Boeing is testing electric airplanes. There's enormous change that's going on, and I think we need to celebrate the advances that we've made, knowing that there's a lot more that needs to be done, and recognizing we're in the process of transformation. And yes, we are working to get the science into policymaking, but also into the hands of the communities and the businesses that are making a difference already.
Thank you. Does anyone else? Johan, please.
Yeah, so Laurie, I can just say that, I think that's something that Peter Schlosser is here as well, with whom I co-chair the Earth League, and we've been discussing this a lot, that the birth of the 10 new insights in climate science comes out of a frustration, comes out of the fact that we in the scientific community have felt that it's been difficult for us to really have not only rapid communication of the science into the policy community at the negotiations, but also to try as best as we can to offer the scientific evidence as a scaffolding, as the boundary conditions for policy, that you cannot continue compromising with science all the time. It's very difficult to, you cannot negotiate with the planet. You cannot negotiate with the atmosphere. These are physical limits. And you're simply hurting yourself if you underestimate the power of the Earth system, and therefore also the value of having science able to keep a quantitative check on checks and balances on how we're doing in relation to all the planetary boundaries. And what we're seeing as a red thread of the science is that the health research, the social sciences, the economic research, the governance research is coming more and more centrally, also showing the need of systemic changes and very rapid shifts. So of course, I think the importance of science, I mean, it's very popular to say that, well, the science is settled. I mean, we don't need more science, we just need to act. Well, I would argue we need the science more than ever, because the science is advancing so rapidly, and it's advancing in an interdisciplinary way. It's just like Christy says, all these 10 could have been one insight, because they're all interconnected. And that is the complexity that we face, and we simply need that deep understanding to be central also to the climate negotiations.
Thank you. Lisa, please.
Just to add something, I think that's really crucial here, and we see this certainly in the IPCC Working Group 2 report, is that the huge amount of more social scientists who are involved in the assessment of the science. So it actually becomes much more, it's closer to the policy than, I think, the natural science, and therefore that, I think, also helps give us these tools, the sort of entry points for the discussion that links it closer to the policymaking processes.
Thank you. Do we have our online panelists? Would you like to add anything? Mercedes, please.
Just reinforcing the point made by Lisa, the relevance of social science in the discussion about climate change. I think this is a major turning point, because it's really coming closer to the society, to the companies, to the financial sector. So how we can deliver this message in a more clear way, and trying to track more action. I think that this is an important component too. Thank you.
Thanks. Aditi, do you have anything to add?
No, not really. I'll take another one. I think all that needed to be said has been said.
Thank you. So I'm looking around the room. There's another question in the front here, and I see two more after that. Could we have the microphone here in the front? And we have 5 minutes or 4 minutes remaining of the press conference.
It's Masato Kimura, Japanese freelance journalist. My question is about finance to Yuan. So I think Market needs a free competition, but in this case, you need a direction and restriction to calm the finance to certain directions. And how can you overcome this paradox in your idea?
Yeah, I think this is an area of, let's call it scientific disappointment, because I would argue that we, in the research community, have solutions for this. I mean, already Nick Stern in the Stern Review made clear that human-caused climate change is the world's largest market failure. And if we just put the right price on carbon, we can have a conventional market economy operating, but just internalizing all the externalities would in itself tip the scales immediately. I mean, most science shows that the social cost of carbon is something in the order of $200 per ton of carbon dioxide. The highest price of carbon we have in the world today is in the European Union, €100 per ton of carbon dioxide. For the rest, it's much too low. And I would also argue that if you combine price on carbon with setting 1.5 degrees Celsius equivalents for all the planetary functions, that would in itself give the market very clear signals of where we need to innovate and transform. So I think we can actually work with the current market economy and get acceleration.
Thank you. Now, so we have a question here in the middle, and then we have a question over there, and we'll try to get through these rapidly in our last 2 minutes. Please identify yourself, and if you're directing your question to a particular panelist.
Yeah, Joydeep Gupta from the Third Pole and Climate Change Media Partnership. A specific question on health, because as you point out, very little of the money is going into it, while more and more health impacts are showing up. So what exactly is the agenda now for all the health scientists? How are you going to take this forward?
Thank you, and I only have a very short period of time to try and give an answer. We know from COVID that our health systems are really unprepared for shocks and stresses. Climate change is a massive shock and stress that's already affecting many countries. So the first is investing in our health systems in an integrated way where we take into account not just human health, but animal health, nature, all of the other drivers that affect our health and our well-being. After that, we've got a very large toolbox. Early warning systems, for example, save lives and are an important approach to reduce mortality from heat, to reduce people suffering from vector-borne diseases. And I'm happy to answer more later.
Thank you. And our final question over here, please.
Thank you. It's Madeleine Cuff from The New Scientist. I wanted to ask about loss and damage. This is probably a question for Johan. You said that there's an urgent planetary need to address loss and damage. I wonder if you can elaborate on the scientific basis for that. And surely the decision to act is a political choice, right? It's a policy response. So just how that connection is made.
Ask one of the other panelists if they want to address that.
Does one of the online panelists wish to tackle this one? Aditi?
Yeah, I could. I think the scientific advance that we are...
We don't hear you very well. Can we turn up the volume?
Can you hear me?
Yes, now we hear you.
Yeah, okay. So I think the scientific advance that really helps us in the cause for furthering loss and damage agenda is really this attribution science, which now allows us to say what is the fingerprint of climate change in that disaster or in that hazard, which then leads to a disaster for all kind of human-made reasons. So I think that's a relatively new advance in climate science, and that really helps in quantifying loss and damages and related to climate change much better. And if I can very briefly take the previous finance question, I think there is also a big gain that can be made by repurposing some of the existing subsidies. I work in South Asia a lot, and here a lot of the work we do, say in irrigation, also involves a lot of fossil fuel subsidies, and they can be easily repurposed for renewable energy. Some of it has been done, but there is a huge unmet scope for those kind of repurposing of those expenditures. So I'll stop there.
Thank you. Thank you. So unfortunately, we've run out of time. I'd like to thank our panelists for joining us, particularly those online who've joined us at very early in the morning. And thank you all for coming. Great.